A warm welcome to you all in the blessed name of our Savior Jesus Christ. It's indeed a joy that you are here on this first day of the month in the dawn service. Dear people of God, we shall worship the Lord with all of our hearts and minds. Isaiah chapter 55, 6. Seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word. Dear people of God, as we step into this new month, we need God with us. We need Emmanuel with us so that we might face the challenges which is ahead of us this month. As we have given this first hour of the day into his hands, we will worship him with all of our hearts and minds. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you, we adore you. Lord, you are the God of eternity. You are the God who was with Abraham. You are the God who was with the early church. Now, Lord, you are the same God who is working with us in this generation. Lord, you have not changed. And we praise you, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we have come on this first day of this month to surrender our lives, to submit ourselves as KMC family into thy hands, so that, Lord, you may lead us and guide us. We need you at each moment of our lives. We want to worship you through our lives. Lord, we pray that you bless each one of us as we have gathered here. We commit this time into thy hands, the praises that we are going to sing, the word that we are going to meditate, the offerings that we are going to offer, and the fellowship that we are part of on this online platform. Let everything be a worship to you. In Jesus' most blessed name we pray. Amen. Dear people of God, we shall rise and sing hymnal 455, Crown Him with Many Crowns. As we sing this, let us joyfully open up our hearts and minds. It's not just a traditional worship service, but it is a worship service where we are calling on God to be our Father and Shepherd for this new month. Crown Him with many crowns.
Oh,
Dear people of God, as we are gathered this morning, we shall be part of the communion. As we prepare ourselves, let us together recite this Apostles' Creed as the historic confession of faith. Let us come together through confessing this Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Dear people of God, as we are here this morning, let us continue to worship the Lord with these songs of praise. As we sing this, we shall sing it prayerfully, opening up our hearts and minds, completely depending on Him for who He is. Let us spend some time in singing these praises to our Lord.
Everything that has been praised. Thank you.
Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the Creator and Sustainer of the universe. Blessed be thy holy name, O Lord. The God who spoke to us through your living word, Isaiah 55:6 says, seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near. Let us worship the living God who is near to us, who is willing to be in our midst, who is willing to listen to our worship, to respond to our worship. Lord, we praise you, we worship you, we adore you. Yes, Lord, your thoughts are not our thoughts. Your ways are not our ways. You know the timing for our lives. You know each and everything of this universe. The whole universe is in your control, O Lord. We thank you, we praise you. We acknowledge that and adore you and worship you this morning. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Yes, Lord, we come before your throne of grace this morning to worship you. We want to surrender ourselves. So we want to surrender our families, our church into thy hands. We need you every moment of our lives. Lord, we have come this early morning just to acknowledge that you are the Father of our lives. You are the Father of our families. You are the Father of the church that we belong to. Lord, we cannot afford to leave you at any moment. We don't have anybody apart from you. We don't bow before anybody, Lord. We don't have any other gods apart from you. Loving heavenly triune God, we bow before you in adoration and worship. Lord, this morning we confess that we are the sinners, because as we have come together before your throne of grace, each one of us can see ourselves sinful before you, because you are holy and we are unholy, O Lord. In our minds, in our hearts, through our lips, through our work, Lord, we have sinned against you. We plead that you forgive us this morning. Cleanse us through your precious blood and make us whole. Lord, we pray for our church and all the family members, all the families which belongs to us. Lord, we pray that your grace may be abundantly upon each one of the family members. We pray for our youths, our children, Lord, our elderly people. We need your grace upon each one of us, so that, Lord, your blood may cleanse each one of us of our sins. Give us the grace to repent this morning. If we are part of this dawn worship service, give us the grace to repent before your throne of grace. Even before we come to your table, Lord, to partake in the communion, we pray, give us the grace to confess our sins open-heartedly, not self-justifying, but Lord, come before you, because we know the ministry of the Holy Spirit is to convict us, and you are here in our midst to convict us. Lord, help us to open up our minds and hearts to be convicted by your presence, by your ministry. Lord, we pray, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive others' trespasses against us. Lord, this morning we also thank you for all the grace and mercy that you have bestowed for the past 6 months, O Lord. We have come to the 7th month now. It is only your grace that has sustained us in spite of many uncertainties around us. Lord, we are in the midst of medical pandemic. We are in the midst of cultural pandemic, O Lord. We pray that your grace may be upon us, and you have answered us for the past 6 months. We thank you. We praise you. We worship you. Even though we are not gathering in this building as a church, Lord, you have still kept us intact as a church through this virtual media. Lord, we thank you for all the technology that is in our midst to move forward even through this fellowship. Lord, we thank you for this precious time that we have come together. This morning, help us to prepare ourselves to partake in the communion. Give us the grace to remember all that you have done for the past many years in our lives. Give us the grace to be grateful to all that you have done. Lord, we thank you for this precious time to come together as KMC family, as a church, as a body of Christ. Lord, being our head, Lord, we pray that you lead us and guide us every moment of our lives. This morning, we also remember our Bishop, Bishop Amma, and all the conference leaders. Lord, use them for your revival. Use them for your will to be done in the Methodist Church in India. Lord, as they lead the congregations, the churches, we pray your special anointing upon them and also the wisdom that they need to lead us and guide us. We also pray for our district superintendent and all the pastors of the conference, O Lord. We commit them into thy hands. Be with them. Be with us as a pastoral team of KMC and lead us and guide us. Lord, we specially remember Pastor Martin as he brings the word this morning. We pray that your special anointing may be upon him. Speak to us on this first day of this month so that, Lord, we may hear your voice through this word that we are going to receive this morning. Help us to receive that word and also prepare ourselves. Help us to receive the word and also to repent before you. And Lord, let your name be glorified in all that we do. Lord, this morning we also pray for all the activities of the church. Even though we are doing it in a limited way, you are being with us. We thank you for the Bible study. We thank you for the Sunday school. We thank you for all the online worship services that we are able to keep going. We thank you for every blessing. Thanks for the people behind that. Thanks for all the people who are praying for this pandemic, O Lord. We too come together with one accord this morning to pray for this medical pandemic which is all over the world. Lord, we need you. We need your grace and mercy upon us. We need you for your intervention. Lord, we are waiting for your intervention. Unless you, Lord, come into the picture, the world will never be saved. Lord, we pray that you lead the pharmaceutical companies who are working day in and day out for the vaccine, O Lord. Give them the grace to work on this so that, Lord, they may come out with your help, a vaccine for the whole mankind in this world. Lord, we also remember all those families who have lost their dear ones. Lord, we pray that your precious grace may be upon each one of those family members. Lord, show your mercy upon the situation. We need you, Lord. We need you at every moment of our lives. Lord, we especially pray for the governments who are working day in and day out for this crisis, O Lord. We pray for the policemen and also the medical staff who are working. Lord, we pray that your protection may be upon them. And Lord, unless you intervene in these situations, we know that, Lord, there will be no solution for this. Lord, it has been in your control. You are the Almighty God. You are the one who can control this. You are the one who can wipe away this whole pestilence, the plague around this globe. We pray that your grace may be upon the humanity. Lord, we completely submit and surrender ourselves into thy hands. Be with us and guide us as we move forward. This morning, Lord, we also remember all those families who are not well, particularly those individuals who have been hospitalized. We thank you for your grace and mercy upon few of our church members who have gone through medical procedures, who have gone through surgeries, who have gone through medical treatment. Lord, you have heard our prayers and you have answered it. You have sustained our families. You have sustained our children from danger, Lord. You have sustained elders of our church. We pray that your grace may be abundantly upon each one of our family members. Protect us under your wings. We depend on you completely. Be with us and guide us. Even as we continue to worship you through our praises and worship, Lord, we pray that you accept our worship and answer our prayers and respond to our needs so that, Lord, your name be glorified. Lord, we commit each one of us into thy hands and be with us. In Jesus' most blessed name we pray. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our trespasses, as we forgive others trespasses against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and from Jesus Christ our Lord. Dearly beloved in Christ, what an awesome time to worship the living God at this early hour of this morning, which God has granted to us. The best part of our life is that God is with us, as we could be able to step into this new month despite the challenges and upheavals we are facing each day of our lives. Dearly beloved, is it really possible to us to recount all the blessings of God which He has bestowed on our lives all through the last month? We can't even remember any blessings of God and have tendency of forgetting all that we have received from God. But God has not forgotten us, not even our names, so that He can shelter us and protect us and lead us with His holy presence. As we start the new month, let us be revived through the Word of God, so that we can also be sheltered under His holy wings as we come across the challenges or temptations or troubles that come ahead of us. Today, for our short reflection, I have chosen the holy passage from the letter of Paul to the Romans, chapter 8, verses 28 to 39. Here the Word of God says, "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to His purpose, for those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, in order that He might be firstborn among many brothers. And those whom He predestined, He also called, and those whom He called, He also justified, and those whom He justified, He also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also with Him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who is indeed interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword, as it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long, we are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." This is the word of God. May God add His blessings to the reading and hearing of His words. Amen. I have entitled my sermon as "Facing Challenges of Life with Christ." Facing challenges of life with Christ. Before we meditate upon the Word of God, let us look to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Most merciful Father, our Creator and Sustainer, we thank You and give You praise for bringing us to a time of worship, a time to know Your words, a time to understand Your unconditional love towards humanity. We are very thankful to You, O God, this morning for this dawn worship service. As we are enabled to see this beautiful day and to be a part of your living creation, O Heavenly Father, as you have called us to a time of meditating upon your holy word, we beseech thy holy presence amidst of us. Father God, talk to me this morning and reveal the treasures of your holy word, O God, and talk through me to your people and help us understand the purpose of your word into our lives as we step into this new day of the new month, O Heavenly Father. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Dearly beloved in Christ, Paul in this text is saying that we know from observation of God's past dealing with those who love him that he has a mysterious way of working things out for the greatest good. God can take whatever evil may come our way and redeem it from good. We can know this because he has been doing it for generations. So Paul is not merely saying that his readers should intuitively know how God works things out for those who love him. Paul is saying we know that is true of God today by observing what he has done in the past for those who loved him. We have a great cloud of witness that have gone before us, as Hebrews chapter 12 verse 1 says, giving evidence of God's trustworthiness towards all who enter into covenant with him. One thing that grabs our mind this morning is that if we try to understand the text, we see that God is providing comfort for those in suffering by reminding them to observe God's dealing with others who love God throughout history. Notice that this truth is not applicable for everyone. It is specifically an observation of those who love God or those who trust in Christ. The point is not that God causes everything for a good purpose, but that God redeems the evil for a good purpose in the lives of those who love him. God does not cause the evil for his purposes, but instead he redeems the evil for a good purpose. Dear God's people, let us try to understand this text with three important points. The first point is, be assured that God works for you. Be assured that God works for you. Verse 28 of Romans chapter 8 says, and we know that all things God works for good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Dear God's people, Paul assures us that God is not absent God, who having created the universe or who created us will not leave us just like that. But rather, since from our birth, he is actively working every moment of our lives, every second, every hour and every day without leaving us to experience the painful situations of our lives. He is same God of the first century who came to the earth to assure us that he is with us. Dearly beloved, God is not like humans who think to spoil the life of someone. He is not cruel like we humans who always delight in causing troubles and dropping obstacles in people's path. Instead, he is actively working good to help us in every situation of our lives. This assures us that God works through everything that happens to us. That is, in all circumstances, whatever situation we are in, however worried, depressing or seemingly fruitless, we can be sure that in that very situation, God is working for our good. Paul is not claiming that bad things happen to us for our good, but that when bad things happen, God works good through them. The emphasis here is not on the all things, but on God Himself. It is He who works. God's constant initiative to work good is not indiscriminate, but on behalf of those who love Him. That is not in vain to deny that God also works to bring those who do not yet love Him to Himself, as Luke chapter 19 verse 10 says, "The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." But for those who believe, there is a special sense in which God is always at work, in all circumstances and at all times. Paul makes the point that all of this is tied in with the purpose of God. Those who love Him, in whose life He works, have been called according to His purpose. And when He works good in our lives, that work is according to His purpose. In other words, God is not blessing us blindly, merely for the sake of blessing, although that God be perfectly in character for Him. More than that, He is working in us towards His ultimate purpose, that we should have a complete union with Jesus. Dearly beloved, through this verse, we by no doubt are assured that God is able to turn evil into good. One of the early church bishops, Tertullian, says that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. Even during difficult times towards humanity, be it the persecution or hardships, the church in all over the world have never ceased to grow even at the point of death for their faith, but the church is flourishing rather than being crushed. Dearly beloved, God is able to not only initiate events, but respond creatively to every evil attacks. He is able to turn evil back on itself and bring ultimate victory. As Robert Schuller used to always say, that God turns stumbling blocks into stepping stones. God turns stumbling blocks into stepping stones. This is how God works for His people, dear God's people. One most important thing I would like to tell you this morning is that if you have faith in God, then never give room to doubt on God's time, because He works for our good. He works everything for our good. The second point here is, as we will be pondering upon, is be assured of God's eternal plan for you. Be assured of God's eternal plan for you. Verse 29 and 30 says, "For those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of God, likeness of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those He predestined, He also called. Those He called, He also justified. Those He justified, He also glorified." Having said that, God worked things for the good of those who called according to His purpose. Paul now expands on what that purpose is really about. Here we see a 5-stage process of God dealing with us. First, He foreknew us, then He predestined us, then He called us and justified us and will glorify us. The first aspect of these 5 stages is those God foreknew. It's a recurrent theme in both the New Testament and the Old that God has known us from before our birth, even from before the foundation of the world. We see in Ephesians chapter 1 verse 4 that says, He chose us in Him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in His sight. This theme is more fully developed in Psalms 139 verse 15 and 16, which says, My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. In the Bible, the concept of knowing something indicates much more than awareness of them, which includes connotation of care, intimacy, and love. The second aspect here in this verse, Paul tells us about in verse 29, which says, He also predestined to be confirmed to the likeness of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers. Predestination refers to God's eternal decision to make us His own, a decision made before the foundation of the world. Then His call refers to the specific moment in our lifetime when He draws us to Him. God's call is first of all to repentance. He calls us to repentance. We see this clearly in the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter verse 40, verse 17, which says, Remember, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Repent, for the kingdom of God is near. Dear God's people, here one thing we should focus is that those who respond to the call to repentance, God freely gives the gift of justification, that is, being made just, free from sin, and saved from all condemnation. The important thing to grab about justification is that it is something that God does, and that once it has been done, it can never be undone. Romans chapter 5 verse 1 tells us that since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God. And verse 33 and 34 of this very chapter, Romans 8, makes it clear that there can be no condemnation for those whom God has justified. It is a finished work. And further, Paul makes it more clear about the purpose of God in His people, that those whom He justified, He also glorified. Glorification here refers to our final completion, dear God's people, our being made perfect in heaven. The interesting thing here is that Paul describes our glorification, which clearly lies in the future. Paul is saying that our future glorification is so certain that Paul wrote about it as though it were already accomplished. The key thing to take from this five-step process of salvation is that in all five steps, the initiative and power lies with God. The initiative and power lies with God. It is He who knew us before He made the world, who chose us, who called us, who gave us the free gift of righteousness, and who will ultimately bring us to perfection and completion in Him, dear God's people. The third point and the last point is, be assured of your security. Be assured of your security, as verse 31 to 39 of Romans chapter 8 deals with. Dearly beloved in Christ, do you believe that God is there to take care of us? Why are we so worried? What will harm us? What will trouble us? Will hardship? Will persecution? will famine, will nakedness, will danger, will sword, will death, will life, will angels, will demons, will the present time, will the future, will any power, will any height, or will any depth. My dearly beloved in Christ, let me put it more clearly before you this morning. If God is for us, who can be against us? No one, dear God's people. Will He not graciously give us all things? Yes, my dearly beloved, He gives us everything. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? No one, dear God's people. Who is he that condemns us? There is no one who condemns us. Who will separate us from the love of God, dear God's people? Absolutely no one in heaven, in hell, nor on the earth, dear God's people. Dearly beloved in Christ, today we are at war with three powers which are fighting against us. The world, this sinful system, is fighting against us. It wants us to conform to its image, which is the image of materialism, which is the image of hatred, which is the image of enmity, which is the image of putting someone down. It wants us to keep us from serving Christ fully, dear God's people. The second is flesh, which is fighting us every day in our lives, dear God's people. We learned in Romans that now as believers, there is a war between our flesh and our spirit. It wants us to hinder and get us off track in order to follow its lust, dear God's people. The devil and his army of demons are very much our adversaries. They hate us because we are made in God's holy image and because we are redeemed. But none of these can compare to God, dear God's people. None of these will be compared to God. Today, as I conclude this short reflection, let me invite you all to the Lord's table with a great assurance that you are not alone to fight the battle of your life, dear God's people. You are not alone to fight the battle of your life alone, because God is with us. Because God is with us. The world tries to put us down, but there is God at our side to lift us up. There is God at our side to lift us up when people try to put us down. Then on whom to keep our trust, dear God's people? There is a passage which helps us understand and find answers to this question. I would please urge all of you to turn the Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 5 to 18. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 5 to 18, which says, "Thus says the Lord, cursed are those who trust in mere mortals and make mere flesh their strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord. They shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when relief comes. They shall live in the parched places of the wilderness, in an uninhabited salt land. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. They shall be like a tree planted by water, sending out its root by the stream. It shall not fear when heat comes, and its leaves shall stay green. In the year of drought, it is not anxious, and it does not cease to bear fruit, dear God's people." This is the great assurance that God gives us this morning as we face the challenges of life with Christ, dear God's people. As we live our life, we need to trust in the Lord. We need to make God our fortress. We need to make God our refuge as we are stepping into this new month, dear God's people. May God help us understand that we are not alone in this world. People may try to put us down, but there is God who will lift us up and help us face the challenges of our lives, because He is with us. May God continue to bless us all. Amen.
Dear people of God, it's indeed a joy to welcome you all in the blessed name of our Savior Jesus Christ. You have been so faithful in participating in this dawn worship service, and we thank God for all of you. May God continue to lead us and guide us. We also would like to pray for all those who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you on this first day of this month. We especially remember all those who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries in this week. Bless them abundantly. Lord, give them the grace, give them the peace which surpasses all understanding. Help them to step into the new year with a grateful heart, depending on you completely, so that, Lord, they may see your power upon their lives, upon the work of their hands, upon all their efforts to reach out to you and to be closer to you. Speak to them through your word. Help them to spend much time in prayer and in your word. Give all the blessings as they work professionally in their workplaces, so that, Lord, they may yield 100-fold of the rewards for their hard work. We commit their families into thy hands. Be with them and guide them. In Jesus' most blessed name we pray. Amen. Dear people of God, we also would like to thank you for all your responses, and we thank you for your suggestions with regard to the online worship service. If you have any problem in offering your offerings or tithes through the online worship service using the QR code, we urge you that you contact us over the phone through our office or to the pastors. We will reach out to you to help you offer your offerings to the Lord. Continue to pray for the church. Continue to be connected with the network of the fellowship of group of believers among us. If you need any prayers or any pastoral help, we are there to help you. Let us continue to move on even through this crisis. God is with us, and we will move forward as we prepare ourselves to offer our offerings and also to prepare to partake in the communion. Let us joyfully sing this hymnal 415, Alas Did My Savior Bleed. As we sing this song, as we sing this hymn, we pray that we offer our offerings to the Lord prayerfully, so that God may bless each one of us for what we do for Him. And God will certainly reward us for what we will do for Him. Let us sing joyfully, Alas Did My Savior Bleed. As we sing this, we will prepare ourselves to partake in the communion.
order for the administration of the sacraments of the Lord's Supper, the Holy Communion. Ye that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God.
Let us humbly confess our sins by saying all together this confession. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word and deed against thy divine majesty. We do honestly repent and heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us. Most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all of them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn to thee, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. These are the comfortable words that Jesus speaks to his children. He says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the expiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby the offering of himself a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father. We most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his passion, death and resurrection, may be partakers of the divine nature through him. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft you shall drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. Shall we all join in this prayer together? We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather of the crumbs on thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to partake of this sacrament of thy Son Jesus Christ, that we may walk in newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Dear people of God, as I take the bread in my hand and also say these words, then you can also take the bread in your hand, and after saying the sentence of prayer, then you can have along with us. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for thee, preserve thy soul and body unto everlasting life. Take and eat in this in remembrance that Christ died for thee, and feed on him in thy heart by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. You can take the bread now. Now you can take the grape juice or water in your hands, in the cups. As I say this prayer, after the prayer you can have this as a symbol of Christ's blood. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for thee, preserve thy soul and body unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for thee, and be thankful. Now we can take the grape juice as a symbol of Christ's blood. Dear God, as we have participated in this online communion at this time, we uphold each one of us as we have participated in your table, partook your body and blood. Continue to bless each one of us, sanctify our lives, give us grace to be connected to you, and help us to be ever grateful unto you for what you have done on the Calvary's cross for our redemption, O Master. Lord, let your grace and abundant mercy be poured upon each one of us to bear much fruit unto you, reflect your life, spread the fragrance of your life, love through our lives, O Master. We thank you, we praise you. We commit once again, each one of us who have participated in this online communion, into your care. We give you all glory, honor, praise unto your name. Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As a reverence to God, please stand wherever you are and join in the closing prayer which is displayed on the screens. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thy humble servants desire fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and thy whole church may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy and lively sacrifice unto thee. Humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. And although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. Let us receive the benediction of God. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among us, and remain with us always. Amen. Thank you.